Blog Talk Radio.
Selah here on 17 Numa Radio on Blog Talk Radio. Tonight is January 21st, 2019, and this is episode 14 of Songs of Selah. I'm your host, Scott Thomas Outler. And on tonight's show, in just a little while, we'll be joined by Adam Levon Brown, poet from Oregon, whose work I've been following for several years now. And before he joins us, there's just a few notes I wanted to go over briefly. Wanted to thank once again Red Fox from Alien Buddha Press and Jay Miner of Rust Belt Press for joining the program last Monday. Had a lot of fun with that show, interviewing and talking with them. And also in the second hour, tried something different with an open mic segment where phone lines were open, and had a really good time, and appreciate everyone who called in and read their work on that episode. Looking forward to trying that format again coming up here in the future. Not sure if I'm going to do one in February in that style, but I know that John D. Robinson, poet and editor of the Rye Whiskey Review, is going to be joining the show in March, and we're talking right now about trying to set something up for another open mic segment in the second hour of that show. So that's going to be a lot of fun. And on another note, I wanted to mention a journal that I'm associated with called Setu Mag. They publish each month a couple of different versions. One is in Hindi and the other is an English version out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And in the current January edition that they're finishing up at the moment, there's a special section dedicated to Indian poets who write in English. That's being guest edited by Gopal Lahiri. And that's going to be coming out at the end of January. And I was contacted recently by Sunil Sharma on behalf of Setu, who told me that they're going to be doing another special edition for Western Voices coming up at the end of February. And he asked me if I'd like to guest edit that edition, which I told him that I would. And so wanted to announce here tonight for any poets that might be out there that submissions are now open for that Western Voices edition. And I posted those at my website, 17numa.com. They're the latest post, so anyone who might be interested in submitting some work for that, or if you know anyone who might, please feel free to share and spread the word around. Looking forward to reading submissions and writing the introduction for that edition coming out in Setu next month. And also wanted to mention that for anyone in the Atlanta area that might be listening, I was invited to read at A Novel Idea, which is a monthly event hosted around the Atlanta area coming up on February 5th. So details about that are also at 17numa.com. And I read recently at their January event, and that is up on my YouTube channel if anyone wants to check that out. So coming up after the break, we're going to play one more song here, Disposition by Tool, and then we will be joined by Adam Levon Brown. Thanks for tuning in. Welcome back to Songs of Selah. We are having a bit of technical difficulties getting Adam on the line right now, but we're working to get that straightened out at the moment. And so I'm going to play another song. This is a past guest on the show, Vlada Mars, pianist from up in Canada. Archives to all the past episodes, I should have mentioned this earlier, are available at 17numa.com or here on the Blog Talk radio page that you're probably listening to. So this is a track off of Vlada Mars' most recent album called Moonbeam.
Thank you.
is tracks by Vlada Mars off of her latest album, and it looks like we have got things figured out here, so I'm about to bring Adam onto the line. Want to read a brief introduction here first. Adam Levon Brown is an internationally published poet and author in 14 countries. He has had his work translated into Spanish, Albanian, Arabic, and Afrikaans. Boasting over 300 published pieces, you can find his writing at such publications as Burning Word Literary Journal, Firefly Magazine, Zany's Dot Review, Epigraph, Angel City Review, and Aerial Chart. He was long listed in the 2016 Urbachi Prize Poetry Competition and received a special mention recently in the Pangolin Prize 2008 competition. Brown is founder, owner, and editor-in-chief of Madness Muse Press, LLC, as well as assistant editor at Literary Arts Journal. He also volunteers as part of the social media team for the Oregon Poetry Association. In addition to all of his accomplishments, Brown celebrates 3 collections of poetry, as well as 3 poetry chapbooks. You can find his work as well as extra goodies at his website, adamlevonbrown.com. So, welcome to the show, Adam.
Thank you, Scott. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, great to hear you. Sorry about those technical difficulties, but got to fly by the seat of our pants in life sometimes. Glad that everything got connected here in the end. It's great to have you on, my friend.
Thank you.
So let's dive right in and maybe tell us a little bit about how you got into poetry. Where did that love for the written word originate, and maybe a little bit about whatever your most recent project is. What's got you on fire right now?
Okay, well, I originally got into poetry, I'd say 2015, beginning of 2015. I was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder around that time. And I was having a very hard time coping with my illness. And
hey,
so
Adam, can I jump in real quick? Do you have, can you put your computer on mute? Because it's given the echo of the show in the background there.
Sure, yeah. And hey, Adam. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. That's better.
Okay.
Okay, so you're talking about how you were getting into poetry. Sorry for the interruption.
No problem. Yes, I was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder, and so I needed a way of catharsis to deal with my illness. And, writing just seemed like the perfect tool. I've always been kind of a writer. When I was 5, I used to write in little journals that my dad gave me, and it's just stuck with me ever since.
Using that process, I've read some of your past interviews as catharsis and almost a therapeutic tool.
I
can identify
with
that a lot. A lot of poets, I'm sure, can. Definitely a way to get everything out and deal with it. So, you're a absolutely on fire all the time with how many submissions you send out. I follow your work on social media, and definitely an inspiration with how hard you work at it. So what was it like there in the beginning? You said you started around 2015 getting published. What was that process like, and starting to learn about the sort of the indie press and all those journals and communities that are out there?
Well, it was really hard at first. I didn't know anything about the submission process when I first started. I was sending my first poems to poetry magazines and journals like Poetry Foundation Magazine, and I just got rejected for a good 6 months before I figured out what I was doing.
Yeah, it's almost, I don't know, hard to say this, but it's good for the soul, rejection in a certain sense, especially when you do start having some success, which you've obviously had, getting those acceptances rolling in, it kind of keeps us humble in a certain way to keep shooting for the larger journals. And even if those rejections come, such a subjective process with all the different editors out there and what they might be looking for. So, which brings me to, I guess, my next question. It being such a subjective field, poetry, What do you think about the different styles, and what are your different styles and formats that you try to write in generally?
Well, I mainly write in free verse, but I try to do a new theme and a new type of free verse with each book. Like, I just finished a slam poetry book, and I'm also working on a beat poetry book.
Oh, very cool. That beat one sounds particularly interesting. So are you influenced by Kerouac and Ginsberg and all those guys?
Yes. I'm a big fan of Ginsberg, especially, and Kerouac and all the beats, of course. Yeah.
Who are some of the other poets that you've read in the past that inspire you?
Edgar Allan Poe. He's the first poet I ever read. He really influences my work as I try to stay on the dark side of poetry.
Right.
It just melts with me and my whole character. Who else? Andrea Gibson, Dante Collins, T.S. Eliot, and that's about it.
Okay. I think I first met you back probably around 2015, like you were saying, in the Section 8 Zine that Michael Perkins puts out or used to publish out of there in Seattle. I think we were in an issue of that together. That's when I first came across your work, I believe. It's been a while.
Yeah,
back
that sounds
now.
Familiar. Yeah.
Yeah, I think.
I remember that.
I think Matt Dugan was in
that
issue
Matt.
As well.
Sorry?
I was thinking, I think Matt Dugan was in that issue as well.
Yeah.
So, how has that learning about the publication process and the submission, doing the submissions yourself, like, when did that turn into an idea of wanting to turn your energy toward becoming an editor and opening up Madness Muse Press? And what has that process been like, running your own press?
Well, what really opened it up for me is after having a few published books by the amazing Creative Talents Unleashed, I decided I kind of wanted to go in that direction. Roger Williams really inspired me with her publishing and her hard work, and I decided just one day that I wanted to start publishing people too, because it seemed really rewarding, and it has been very rewarding.
That's good to hear. So what's the sort of kernel ideology behind Madness Muse Press? What's your agenda behind it and the mission statement that you're trying to get to the world through what you do there?
Our mission statement is enacting social change through the power of writing.
Right on. Okay. That. You've been an activist in your past. I know I've read about that and seen you talking about it. How does that play in and influence what you do?
It plays a lot into it. I used to protest almost every other day. I was very connected with the activist community here in Eugene, Oregon. And I sat on student government, and I did a lot of stuff in college surrounding protesting. And I just kind of, it kind of created a seed within me, and I've let it bloom ever since.
You're put out a anthology, Not My President, I think, a couple of years ago. Does that stem straight out of that activist nature?
Yeah. That was a fun book to work on. There was a lot of talk about it, and I thought it would be a good book to run.
Seems like you got a good response to it. Actually, I was talking to a mutual friend of ours and a past guest on this show, Don Biaquez, earlier, and asked him if he had any questions for you, and one of them was, are you going to send a copy of that anthology along to CNN at any point?
I I may just.
Good deal. He also had a more serious question, I guess. He wanted to know, and I guess this gets back to sort of when you're in an inspired mood and it hits you to put pen to paper or put your fingers on the keyboard, what is that sensation like when you're writing a poem? Is there a rush of adrenaline, for instance? And I guess expanding on that, what is your basic writing routine from day to day?
Well, starting with the routine, I wake up every morning and check my submissions, and I try to write at least 3 to 5 poems every morning. And if I don't have any inspiration in the morning, like I'll write 2 and then write 2 more at night. And as far as the feelings go, I always feel a rush of adrenaline, especially when I get a good image in my mind. I try to translate that onto the page as quickly as possible and then edit it later.
I always liken that process. It's almost like capturing a snapshot in time, trying to flush those emotions out and capture that first draft, which is always like what crystallizes it all. Do you have a preference, writing longhand or typing?
Oh, definitely typing. I use a Logitech G11 keyboard. I've written some poems longhand, but it's just a lot easier for me to type.
Okay. Fair enough. I guess I didn't want to get off Madness Muse so quickly. I should have asked you what other anthologies you've released so far and also what your plans are, you know, here early in 2019. What type of projects do you have lined up with the press?
Well, so far we've done an anthology of women writers called Mermaid Mirror, and that was really fun to work on. We've done
I know you have your... Sure, take your time. I also know that you publish regularly on your blog that's also connected with the press. I've read a lot of great work on there, and also thank you. You've interviewed me on that blog in the past, and a shout-out to your assistant editor there at the site, a friend of this show as well, Hani Zweibel.
Yes. She does a lot of work at the press. I couldn't thank her enough. She pretty much runs the blog. I read the posts, but she's the one who publishes them.
Good deal. Do you have any future anthologies in mind? Or possibilities that you're hashing out?
Yes, we're currently working on an environmental issue, an environmental anthology. I feel it's really important due to the climate crisis. So, we're working on that.
Good deal. Yeah, absolutely. Definitely a topic that can never be expanded on enough at this point in time. Let's talk a little bit about some of the books you've put out personally. What are a couple of your latest collections?
Okay, I put out Embedded Memories of a Shooting Star, and that was through Transcendent Zero Press and Dustin Pickering and ZM Wise. I really thank them for their work. They did a great job on the book, publishing and cover and formatting.
Was that the book was that the book inspired by a dream? It seems like you wrote.
Yeah.
It. Okay. How'd that project come about, or what was the dream that triggered it?
Well, the dream was basically I was half asleep and I saw a meteor zooming by the Earth, and it was kind of a celestial vision. And I saw basically this
this meteor or meteorite, whatever, it somehow melded with the earth, and it seemed to pass a wave of knowledge onto the earth. And it just gave me this idea to write a book about cosmic creation. And yeah,
that sounds great. Yeah, absolutely. Love that idea of the almost astro-theological energy sort of permeating into human consciousness, giving us vision and guiding toward hopefully something greater if we can get our act in order and do things like clean up the environment like you were just talking about with that anthology. It might actually come to pass. Okay, so you put that one out with Transcend and Zero Press. I know you have several collections out. What are some of the others?
I have a book, a collection titled Death Is Not Our Holy Word, and that was put out by Alien Buddha Press of last year. And that was a pretty personal book. Yeah, it was about my battle with depression, and I really tried to show that within the book by adding both themes of death and hopelessness and of cheer and hope. It was a very complicated book to write, and so that's basically what it's about.
I just had an image. You know, you're talking about the trying to share both aspects when it comes to depression, that feeling that we can't get out of course, and then also those high moments that bring us back out of it. And when I was watching that lunar eclipse last night, I went outside when it was about halfway covered and just this brilliant moon in the sky, and it was half black, half white, sort of swiggled through the middle, and it just reminded me of the symbol of Taoism, that yin-yang symbol up there. That's been stuck in my mind the last couple of days, but I don't know, when you were talking about that just now, it sort of triggered it back in. Did you get a chance to see that last night?
No, I actually missed it. It was pretty overcast here in Eugene. I looked for it for a few hours, but it just didn't show.
That's a bummer. But so you live in Eugene, Oregon. Have you always lived there?
Yeah.
Okay. What's the poetry scene like there? I saw in your bio here that you also work with the social media team of the Oregon Poetry Association. So, want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. There's a few local open mics here. I'd say two or three open mics. One is the Wandering Goat. It's a cafe. And there's some readings going on at Kush Cafe. And I just started with the Oregon Poetry Association. They're a nonprofit that operates out of Portland here. And they do a lot of good work.
Sounds promising. Hopefully some good stuff comes out of that here in the year ahead. What about the other journal that you help out with, Caravelle Literary Arts Journal?
Oh, yes. That's with Eric Allen Yankee. I don't know if you're familiar with him. He's a poet from Chicago. Oh, okay.
I should say I'm friends with him on Facebook, but familiar with him.
Oh, okay. That journal, Caravelle, it's kind of been on hiatus lately, and I haven't been doing much work on it.
Okay.
Don't know when it's going to come back, but I hope it comes back soon.
Good deal. So what are you working on currently? What's the main passion right now?
I'm actually working on three books. One of them is a psychological, spiritual book, and the title is Anima, a collection of poems. I'm trying to get that published. And I'm also working on two chapbooks. One is named Math, and it's It's evocative short form poetry and slam poetry combined. I'm trying to push that one around. And I just started a new chapbook called Saltwater, which is about mental illness and overcoming obstacles.
Okay, very cool. You've definitely always got your hands on more than one project.
Yeah, I try to stay busy.
Is that something about your personality, always going, going, going?
Yes, definitely.
When that energy is not geared toward poetry, what other hobbies do you have and try to get into there in Oregon?
Well, I like hiking a lot, and I go on a lot of walks, taking pictures of birds. I'm slightly into photography, but I mostly just go on walks, and I recently started painting again, which is fun.
I saw recently you had a painting accepted somewhere.
Oh, yeah. I had a painting accepted at the Magnolia Review, and I was really excited about that because it's the first painting I've done in around 4 years.
Very cool. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
A good way to kick things back off, get something accepted immediately.
Yeah. I was surprised, to say the least.
So you were talking about some of the open mics there in your area. Do you make it out to some of those? And what are your feelings on live performances?
I appreciate live performances, but honestly, they're not really for me. I haven't done many of them yet. I am planning to try to gear myself in that direction, maybe in 2020. But so right now I'm just into writing and publishing.
Okay. I see that has expanded some. You have a YouTube channel where I've seen some postings of your readings.
Oh, yeah. I decided to make a YouTube channel to elaborate and speak about, a place for my spoken word poetry, which I'm really aiming towards nowadays.
Okay. Well, on that note about reading, do you have anything perhaps on hand that you'd like to share tonight?
Oh, yes. I have a few poems.
Great.
Okay. This poem is titled "Your Whisper Changed Everything." Something jumped into my ear. It was you, talking me down from the roof of my mouth, which wept only one word, suicide. Something collided into my ear. It was you, crashing the automobile in my bumper-spinning mind, which consumed itself in only one word, death. Something cried in my ear. It was you. The baby carriage I once inhabited was gone, and I am still here, though it sits under the mobile, spinning only one word around in my eyes, and something played music into my ear. It was you, holding the record player of my eardrum close to your heart while I considered only one word, escape. Something rattled in my ear. It was you, holding the bottle of pills I had planned to swallow while ruminating on only one word, deceased. Something whispered in my ear. It was you, reminding me of all the best times we had together. All of the lunches, how you taught me how to tie my shoes, how you taught me how to ride a bike, how you always reminded me to put my coat on before going outside, reminding me of the days spent collapsing fears with your words of guidance and your ear of wisdom. Your whisper changed that one word. It changed it into danger signs and assembled en masse across every street corner of my mind while reciting only one word. Brother, your whisper changed that one word. It changed it into looking at skyscrapers from the ground up, turning them into monuments of freedom, while reciting only one word, brother. Your whisper changed that one word. It changed it into a yearning to have a child of my own, and a hope that this baby will never have to face the mobile, which once haunted me, while reciting only one word, brother. Your whisper changed that one word. It changed it into a symphony played between us in open light, while we laughed, with no tears hidden there to hold us down, while reciting only one word, brother. Excuse me. Your whisper changed that one word. It changed it into a pharmacy where medication became the savior and not the enemy to loathe and distrust. While reciting only one word, brother. I knew I was gay and I wanted to end my life. Your whisper changed it all.
Great piece. So, do you have a close relationship with your brother?
Yeah, we have a really close relationship. I've lived with him for the last 7 years, and I've had my bouts with depression and such, and he's really helped me through it.
Very cool to have those support systems in our lives. It's good you have him, and I'm sure that he has you as well. What that raises an interesting point, I think, when it comes to writing about personal subjects, which that last poem obviously was, how much do you draw from your personal experiences, and how much is observations of what's going on in the outer world, or maybe reflections on other art, or what's the combination there that you use most?
I'd say I draw a lot on personal experience, and I try to use, lately I've been following, button poetry, so I've been trying to turn it into slam-like poems.
And that's what that current book that you're working on, coming from that sort of angle?
Yes.
Okay, good deal. You'd like to read another one for us?
Sure, yeah. Prayer to Murda. Harbinger of silent dawn. Martyr of beasts and broken galaxies. Bring me Boethius and handmade stars swept among the dirt of past lives. Excuse me. Sorry, I have a slight cold right now.
Oh, that's okay. Just grab some water or anything. Take your time. We're here with Adam Levon Brown on Songs of Selah. I want to thank him again for joining the program tonight. Anyone who might be listening, if you want to check out past episodes, you can find an archive at 17numa.com. Or if you're listening on the Blog Talk live stream right now, you can click that follow button and get in the loop for any forthcoming episodes coming around the bend. Got a lot of great guests coming up, and appreciative for Adam being here tonight. He's got another poem for us.
Okay, here we go. Prayer to Marta, harbinger of silent dawn, martyr of beasts and broken galaxies. Bring me Boethius and handmade stars swept among the dirt of past lives. Bring me the Titan, encapsulated within supernova truth. Bring me Alexandria, cradled in the silk immortality. Bring me destiny, wrapped in double helix tapestry. Do not bring me saints, for my eyes bleed like chrysanthemums who sit staring at lightning. Do not bring me your broken halo, for I am my own, resting upon the gates of an inescapable dream. Do not bring me carnality, for bodies are vessels hiding behind the Maya and circles of Niagara emptiness. Face the trembling of the neurotic memories of quaking dreams gripped in solar neglect. Sorry about that.
That's okay. So you're a poet. I'm sorry, keep going.
Face the trembling of memories encircling psychotic breaks which were once held in static choirs. Face the trembling of the memories assembling themselves into dreams, while they scrape their iron nails of nightmarish banshee upon the walls of your once hollowed solace. Let us sit within time, grasping for cosmos with fingers of clay. Let us sit inside the Trinity, praying for cracked thunder. Let us stay for one more fractured raindrop, tasted for the finite and swallowed for creation's final whimper.
All right, right on. Your poetry draws on so many different subjects, psychological, mythological, spiritual, religious even, in some instances. I'm wondering, where did your fascination with those subjects come from? Is it something that you studied in school or self-taught?
I'm pretty much self-taught. I always try to broaden my horizon, as they say, when it comes to different subjects. I study a lot. And I try to incorporate it into my poetry. I've always had a really keen interest in psychology. So I like to include psychology mainly in my poems. And yeah.
Yeah, I can definitely sense that in a lot of your work. I guess even with that title of the book you were talking about, Animus, that sort of Jungian schism of dealing with the shadow aspect, and I know that comes up in a lot of your poetry, sort of trying to find the synthesis of those darker aspects of our personality and bring them into alignment with our full self, it seems to me, when I'm reading a lot of your work.
Yes, that's exactly what I try to do with that part of my work. I try to bring awareness to it, and also it's also kind of cathartic in a way, because I'm trying to work with the dark side, not only to create poems, but to maybe fuse it within myself, so to speak.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. writing is an expression or an extension of our personality, so they sort of work and reflect off of each other. All right, do you have another piece that you want to read tonight? And also, are those pieces that you read, are those new or included in past books?
Well, Your Whisper Changed Everything, the first one I read, that was originally published in Aerial Chart.
Right on. Shout out to Mark. Shout out to Mark Anthony Rosie there at Aerial Chart. Does good work.
And Prayer to Marduk is currently unpublished. And here's the last poem I'll read. The title of this is Obelisk. The name of determination has embedded itself into my furious capillaries. I bury storms into my back, collapsing hunger into pebbles. Surviving on silk while granite in approach. I shy cat's eyes away from the hourglass and my dust-burned pride. My fury feeds on hushed stings, separating myopia from the self with sun-baked hands. Fires of creation croon emerald melodies from my coriander eyes, crying for the color crimson which cradles my trauma no longer.
Right. Thank you for sharing those. So, got about 5 minutes left here in the program this evening. I wonder if maybe talk a little bit about what your goals and ambitions are. We're still here in January, so all 2019 still lays out ahead of us. What are your main goals for this year?
I want to get at least 2 books published. It's quite a task, but I want to try to get at least 2 books published. I want to connect with more poets. and just try to put myself out there more by promoting.
What are your thoughts on promoting? How do you generally go about that? And where are some places that people can find your work on social media and websites and things of that nature?
Well, if you just Google my name, Adam Levon Brown, Levon Brown, you can find most of my work on there. Or my website, adamlevonbrown.com. And as far as networking goes, I just try to, excuse me. I just try to connect with people online by adding them as friends and then just talking with them about their work and talking about my work, talking about each other's work. And that seems to work for the most part.
Right, absolutely. It's, that's part of what this community is all about, I think. Everyone sort of inspiring each other. Pats on the back, keep us all going and sort of fighting for the greater cause of trying to make some sort of positive, transformative change in the world in whatever way we can with the voices that we're trying to raise. So definitely appreciate the work that you do with Madness Muse Press and, of course, with your own work, the appreciate the work ethic that you have. I think that's something a lot of people can learn from, just keeping foot on the gas and working hard at all times and just keeping moving forward. So I think those are some great qualities that I've noticed out of you, and so just want to wish you the best here in 2019 as we come to the close here tonight. Are there any final words you want to say to the audience?
If you're a writer, keep writing. If you're not, I would recommend start writing.
There you go. I'll second that notion. I mean, it can't hurt. Like we were talking about earlier, it's a cathartic process, if nothing else.
Yeah.
Something that people can try out. Well, Adam, I appreciate you coming on. I know you're feeling a little under the weather today, and we had a little bit of technical difficulties in the beginning, so I appreciate you hanging with me and coming on tonight. I enjoyed your poems and getting to hear a little bit about your work, and hopefully maybe we can do this again sometime in the future and have another reading from you, my friend.
That sounds great. That would be fun. Yeah, thanks for having me on, Scott.
My pleasure. All right, have a good evening, my friend. And thank you, everyone, who's tuned in here to Songs of Selah this evening on 17 Numa Radio. Please check out past archives at 17numa.com. Anyone who is interested in submitting to that Setu magazine special edition that I mentioned at the top of the show, please check out 17numa.com for that as well. And then, most importantly, do please visit adamlevonbrown.com or look up Adam on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all those good platforms, and check out his work because he's doing great things. So, good thoughts your way, my friends. For the rest of the day, take care.